The major part of the program today is allergic reactions to the COVID-19 vaccines. Yes, there are reactions. Yes, there have been some serious reactions. Get the facts before you make a decision not to take this vaccine. I've got a couple of people in my family, for example. One is a person who's got severe food allergies, tree nut allergies. The other is a person who's had significant allergies to vaccines before. The first one was really not that much of a conversation. He understood. He took his AVQ. It's like an EpiPen. He'll take that with him when he goes to get his vaccination. The other one, again, was a little bit dicier. It's a family member that's had problems with tetanus vaccines in the past. We looked it up. We focused on that for a little bit. I researched a few things about it, and you'll see why that was more of a concern. At the end of the day, she didn't have an EpiPen, an AVQ, but we ordered her one, and she's going to go ahead and get the vaccine. Now, here's the focus on those vaccine reactions. In vaccine trials, Pfizer and Moderna excluded participants with a history of an allergic reaction to any components of the COVID vaccine. Pfizer also excluded participants with a history of severe allergy associated with any vaccine. So that's the second family member that I was just talking about. On December 11th, the FDA issued an EUA, emergency use authorization for Pfizer, the Pfizer vaccine. On December 14th, general vaccination of healthcare started. On December 15th, one day later, a 32-year-old female healthcare worker in Alaska who had known allergies presented with an anaphylactic reaction within 10 minutes after the first dose. Severe cases of anaphylaxis have been reported in the U.S. after vaccinating 2 million healthcare workers. The CDC has then recommended the exclusion of any person who has a history of a severe or immediate allergic reaction associated with any of the vaccine components. And that, if you go back to my original story about my family member, that was the difference. It's not somebody with immediate or severe reactions to any vaccine, it's the vaccine components of this vaccine. There's a specific chemical that we'll talk about in just a second that appears to be the agent that's causing this, the offending agent. It's called, here's the technical name, polyethylene glycol, or PEG for short, P-E-G. So let's talk a little bit more about that. If you're wondering, again, where some of this information is coming from, this was an article in the review article in the New England Journal very recently, just over the past week, about this topic. Now, what is anaphylaxis? Anaphylaxis is a severe reaction. It can kill you. There are no permanent problems with it if you are saved getting through that. And this, the way to save a patient that has that problem is fairly simple, epinephrine. That's why we talked about having that EpiPen or AVQ available for both of these individuals. What's the problem? What does it cause? Well, it's a serious multi-system reaction. It's got rapid onset. You start getting this flushing, your skin turns red. You get laryngeal edema. That means the larynx, the major airway to your lungs, can close up as it swells. That's what causes the immediate life-threatening component. Most everything else, hypotension, low blood pressure, that can cause a little bit of a serious problem. Cardiovascular collapse, those occasionally can cause the problem. But the big problem with anaphylaxis is closing the airway. Epinephrine opens it right back up. Again, you get other things, wheezing, nausea, vomiting, fast heartbeat, again. But the big issue is closing that airway. The cause is activation of mast cells, part of the immune system, through the antigen binding and cross-linking with one of the immunoglobulin families, IgE, or antibody family, IgE. This requires prompt attention and treatment with epinephrine to halt the rapid progression of the life-threatening symptoms. Anaphylaxis is a treatable condition with no permanent effects. Nevertheless, news of allergic reactions have raised fear about the risks of the new COVID vaccine. Acute allergic reactions caused by an antigen, the dead or weakened bacteria, the foreign body, that's what antigen means, or excipient. Now, excipient, I mentioned a few minutes ago that I was gonna talk about what the chemical was in there. Again, that polyethylene glycol. First of all, what is an excipient anyway? So, Before we cover excipients, let's talk about anaphylaxis with previous vaccines. Historically, anaphylaxis with previous vaccines has been more associated with the inactivated components like egg, the gelatin, latex. You know, we used to make vaccines by putting in inoculating eggs with the virus. The virus would go through, make a bunch of the antigen that we wanted. So you had gelatin in there, you had latex in there, you had most of all egg products. So people with egg allergies couldn't take those vaccines. Now this is more of an excipient. What's that? An excipient, it's another ingredient found in very small amounts in a vaccine. Excipients are often preservatives. James and I were talking about this, the reactions, a couple of months ago, and I was thinking, what is that preservative that is often related to vaccine anaphylaxis? Thimerosal was the preservative I was trying to think of. And again, thimerosal is not the problem with the COVID vaccine, it's PEG. Adjuvants. Now, what's an adjuvant? An adjuvant is a small amount of a chemical that inflates or magnifies the immune response to the antigen, to the foreign body. Aluminum salts are an example. And if you've taken the new herpes virus vaccine, the one for older individuals, that one has a lot of adjuvants. That's why people tend to get sicker with that vaccine. Stabilizers. Now, stabilizers will keep the vaccine potent during transportation and storage, for example, sugars or gelatins. Cell culture materials used to grow the vaccine antigens, like I talked about, the egg protein, and ingredients used to kill viruses or inactivate toxins, for example, formaldehyde. So those are the sort of things that you'll see as excipients. You're going to find some of those in there still after the production method. Pfizer and Moderna vaccines use a lipid or fat or / oil-based nanoparticle, meaning a very tiny particle, smaller than microscopic. It's a particle carrier system to prevent the rapid degradation of the messenger RNA and facilitate in vitro delivery. This system's further stabilized by a PEG 2000 lipid conjugate. Now, wait a minute, let's break that down. What does that mean? PEG, again, is polyethylene glycol. Now, never heard of that? It's all over. Most of us are routinely exposed to a lot of household products that include polyethylene glycols. They're used as thickeners, softeners, moisture carrying agents, penetration enhancers, surfactants. We won't go into definitions on that. Widespread in household products from skincare to cosmetics to baby wipes to cleaners. PEGs were long thought to be biologically inert. But there are some pieces of evidence that suggest that maybe not so inert. Health concerns for PEG, contamination of ethylene oxide and 1,4-dioxane, both have some carcinogenic or cancer-causing components. Both compounds are not intentionally added as ingredients to any of these household products. If you look at this slide is mostly talking about polyethylene glycol. It's not so much talking about the COVID-19 vaccines. It's talking about PEG in use in things like Miralax. PEGs are penetration enhancers. When PEGs are in formulations containing toxic ingredients, those ingredients could penetrate the skin more readily. In a 2016 study, as much as 72% have some antibodies to PEGs, presumably as a result of exposure through cosmetics, pharmaceuticals, etc. And about 7% have a high enough level to trigger potential anaphylaxis reactions. So those are the folks that we worry about in terms of these vaccines. PEG is used as an excipient in medications, including the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines. It's been implicated in a rare hidden danger cause of IgE-mediated reactions and recurrent anaphylaxis. The risk of sensitization appears to be higher with the higher molecular weight PEGs. You know, PEGs are a classification of different types of molecules. The higher, the bigger the molecular weight, the more likely there appears to be some ability to sensitize. Anaphylaxis has been associated with bowel prep containing PEG 3350. To PEG 4000. It's been noted in case reports. Again, it's not been seen with much regularity. It's just case reports. For drugs with PEG 3350, like methylprednisolone or injectable steroids, it appears that the PEG component is more likely than the active drug to be the cause of the anaphylaxis. And again, steroids are usually given to reverse anaphylaxis. A patient developed anaphylaxis when first exposed to a PEG lip 5000 ECG contrast, which is labeled with a warning about immediate hypersensitivity reactions. While there were already reports of anaphylaxis with the Pfizer vaccine, the risk of anaphylaxis with the Moderna vaccine it's still been rare enough to not have a good number on it yet. Both Pfizer and Moderna vaccines use PEG 2000, but the two vaccines have different mixtures on this. Implications for vaccines with adenovirus and protein subunits, which is commonly based on polysorbate 80, are currently unknown. Polysorbate 80 and PEG have a similar structure. And again, those are vaccines that are coming down the pike, haven't been authorized yet, but they have a slightly different set of excipients. So, what to do? Here's the thing. I go back to the discussions I had with my own family members that had allergies. First of all, for all of us, understanding these issues is important in terms of deciding about the vaccine. You know, at the end of the day, there's some pick your poison component to this. If there were no such thing as coronavirus, why get the vaccine? You wouldn't need to. But there is a coronavirus out there. And here's the thing. Over the next few months, I don't know if it's 6 months or 18 months, but there are going to be very few people that don't get exposure to that spike protein on the outside of the coronavirus. Here's where the pick your poison comes in. When you get your exposure to that spike protein, do you want it to be associated with live virus or do you want it to be associated with the vaccine? That's your choice. Continue to get great feedback regarding the webinars. And here's why. You know, on the internet, when you hear a webinar, you expect for somebody to try to sell you something. We're not doing that. We're trying to tell you something. People are coming in with their labs from Quest, inflammation panel, OGTT, insulin survey response, and then they're finding out, do I have inflammation? Do I have insulin resistance? And where does that fit in terms of other folks? We're getting ready to start one for CIMT as well. So again, people are really excited about finding out their own status. Looking forward to seeing you there. Thanks.